Now we will see some more methods of string class, and we will try to understand how these contents work. So contents method searches the sequence of characters in this string. If returns true, if sequence of char values are found in the string, otherwise returns false. So if your particular character sequence are found, it will give you true, otherwise it will give you false. The syntax is like this. The return type is a boolean contents, and you supply the character sequence parameter. It will take the sequence of character, returns true if found, otherwise false. Throws null pointer exceptions if sequence is null. So when you supply null sequence, it will give you null pointer exceptions. Now look at the example here. So we have a class, okay, example one, and we have a string name is equal to Bhanu Pratap Singh. So here when you look at here, so let me make one class for that. Example 9, and I will make a main method. In main method, I will copy this data from here, right? Control A, Control Shift F. Yeah. So when you look at the first name dot contents, there is a method called contents method, and we are trying to search the sequence of character, right? So when you put here name dot contents, so you need to supply the sequence of character, and you can search for that. So my given string is a Bhanu Pratap Singh. When I'm searching for BHNAU, the spelling is wrong here, intentionally I have given. Here you will get this. When you try to search this, right, here you will get true. Why? Because this all this character will be present here. When you do about, here you will get false. When you do sync, you will get true. Let me run this. Click on OK. See here, sorry, first two you'll get false, false true. Okay, so why false, false true? Because here the spelling I've given wrong. BH, it should be ANU, but I've given NAU. So when you say sequence of character, so whatever character you give here, it should match with exact character in your string, and this all, you know, all characters are not matching here. Okay, though this N is present here, the A is present here, U is present here, but it will not do character by character comparison. Okay, it will do your given sequence of character. It should match consolidated one. If not, you will get false. So here you will get false, here false, seeing you will get true, right? That's how contents will check. Contents will check for the data into the given strings. The another method called ends with. So ends with, the name itself says that from given a string, you are trying to look for ends with. If it is found, true, else false. Ends with method checks if the string ends with the given suffix. It returns true if the string ends with given suffix, else it will give you false. Syntax, if you look at, this is a syntax. Return type is a boolean. Ends with, it will check with a given a string. If the parameter is found, you will get a true or false. So parameter is the sequence of character again. Look at this example here. We have a class, we have a main method here. We have a string s1 is equal to Bhanu Pratap Singh. Here we are checking that s1 dot ends with. Ends with is a method. If you look at here, here only I can show you. I can just write here name dot ends with. See, ends with is a method here. you can supply particular character here, right? Same thing I am doing here. Ends with, in double quote, I am supplying that H. So H you have here, you will get true. But when you do ends with point, so point is not available here, you will get a false. Even when you supply some character like P, ends with P, still you will get false. So ends with will check for whether in the given string, the particular character which you supply or the particular string which you supply, if it is ending with, you will get a true, otherwise you will get a false. Then equals method. See, this equals will check for the equality of the content of two string. So let's say you have a two string and both the string, if you want to check the equality, you can go for this equals operator. It will check for the content, it will not check for the reference, and it will give you the true false value based on the matching found. The syntax is like this: public boolean equals object, the object which we want to equal. The parameter is another object that is compared with this string, like whatever object you will supply, you want to compare it. It returns true if characters of both strings are equal, otherwise it returns false. It overrides the equal methods of Java object class. So basically this guy comes from the object class, and as we know that object class is the super class in the Java, so this equals methods are overrided from there. Look at the example here. See here, we have a Bhanu, Bhanu, capital Bhanu and Singh. So when we do first two, you will get true. Why? Because both has same content. When you do s1.equals to s3, we will get false here. Why? Because this is capital, this is small. As I said in my previous video, when you want to compare capital small, you can use equals is ignore case. There is a method called equals dot equals is ignore case. Here only I can show you. In this example, you have a method called on the string equals this one, the second, you can see that equals is ignore math. So equals is ignore case, this guy will ignore your upper case and lower case, and it will just compare the string. Okay, so here in this all three, first one you will get true, second one you will get false, because s1 s3 is a capital, s1 is the small, s4 and s1, so s1 is Bhanu, s4 is Singh, so this also you will get as a false. Now another method, equal is ignore case, this will basically will compare the two strings, and it will not check for the case, it will not check for the upper case and lower case, it will just check for the data. Syntax remains same, it will take a string as an argument, parameter remains same, return true if matches, otherwise returns false. Same example here, we have a class, we have main method, we have four variables, a string s1, actually it's a four string object, we would say, because a string is the class, s1 is the Bhanu, s2 is equal to Bhanu, s3 is equal to capital Bhanu, s4 Singh. So when you say s1 dot equals is ignore case s2, you'll get a true here. S1 dot equals ignore case s3 also you'll get a true, because you are ignoring the case sensitive. When you say s1 dot equals is ignore case s4, you'll get a false, because this is Bhanu, this is Singh. That is the reason here you will get false, remaining first two you'll get a true and true. So that's how equals is ignore case works. Now format method, very important method, format method. Format method basically, you know, it will format your given string. It returns the formatted string by given locale, format and arguments. What does mean by that? So if you don't specify the locale in string.format method, it uses the default locale by calling locale.getDefault method. Right? Now look at the syntax. So actually there are two methods. The first one is the static method format. It will take locale, form and object argument. The second one will just take the string and then object. Like what argument you want to have, what argument you want to format. Here if you see the example, you will understand better. So LOC means locale value to be applied to the format method. Form means format of output string, and args means it specifies the number of argument. For format string, it may be 0 or more. So these three parameters we have, and we have definitions for all these three parameters, right? Now it returns the formatted string. So what does mean by that? Like what it returns? Look at with the example. It throws null pointer if the format is null, and it will throw illegal format exceptions if the format specified is illegal or there are insufficient arguments. So you'll get two exceptions here in case of format. One is null pointer if your format is null, or you'll get illegal format exceptions if the format specified is illegal or there are insufficient arguments. This example, example one. We have a class called example one, and we have a static method, main method. We have one variable called, you know, Bhanu Pratap. String str is equal to Bhanu Pratap. Now, when I say string dot format, so here what happens is, let me copy this. So this string dot format, when you look at here, this string is the class, and from that it has a static method called format. So as you know that if the method is static, we can directly call via class name. So when we say here string dot format, right, so there are two overloaded methods. You can see that here the first one requires format and object type, I mean the argument type. The second one with three arguments. So one is locale, a format, and object, right? Now the first one, when we have this format, what happens is when you say my name is percentage s comma str, so this percentage s will get, you know, formatted with the given string which you have supplied Bhanu Pratap. So it will be my name is Bhanu Pratap. So when you say percentage s, which is used for the string formatting, so whatever strings you write after comma, it will get formatted, and this guy becomes my name is Bhanu Pratap. Similarly, when you say string dot format my salary is percentage dot at f, what does mean by that? Percentage dot at f means output is given up to 8 decimal places. Your output will be my salary is 47.657340000, right? So you will get the output till 8 decimal places when you write percentage dot at f. Similarly, when you have here a string dot format my earning is percentage 15 dot at f, which means between my earning is and this there will be a 15 spaces. When you say percentage 15 dot at f so between your name and your earning there will be 15 spaces, right? So percentage 15 means put a 15 spaces, and then you put, you know, 8 and give me the outcome till 8 decimal point. Try to understand with the output, you'll understand better here. Look at this. My name is Bhanu Pratap, which is the output of this guy output. My name is Bhanu Pratap. The percentage s will get formatted with str. Here my salary is 47.657340000. So 8 decimal places, so 20 will get added. You can see that my salary is 47.657340000. My earning is, so what happens when you write here my earning is, there will be a 15 spaces. Okay, my earning is percentage, you know, 15 at f, there will be a 15 spaces. I can show you here. Okay, and if I run this, so let me put one print statement here. And I will print this guy. Okay, it should be a string. Now let me run that. So illegal format, conversions exceptions, long f not long string. Okay, one second. I think I did something wrong here. Let me look at in my notes. Yeah, I should not have, you know, given a double quote. It's not a string, it's a character here. Yeah, now let me run that. I mean, it's not a string, it's a number here. I mean, it's a float point number, not a character basically. Sorry, it's a number with decimal points. And now you see the output. See, my earning is, there is a space, you are getting that because of percentage 15. Okay, so you'll get a space here. And this after 3-4, this 3-0 is getting added because dot at f means 8 decimal point. So it was 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So the remaining 3 you got 3 zeros because you want till 8 decimal points. That's how, you know, format method works in the string class. Similarly, the another example of format method, you have two string. The str1 is equal to Bhanu and str2 is equal to Pratap. So when you say string.format, my name is, when you say my name is %1$s, comma %1$s and %2$s, comma str1, str2. So what happens is your this first one will be treated as first dollar s, the second one will be treated as the second dollar s. So wherever you have a %2$s, the str will get copied here, and wherever you have %1$s, str1 will get copied here. And if you look at the output, my name is Bhanu. So %1$s is str1, which is nothing but here Bhanu, comma, right here, till here you got, okay, my name is %Bhanu, comma %1$s, again Bhanu, and %2$s, which is second string, and Pratap. Okay, so this first dollar will indicate the first string. The second, you know, %2 will indicate the second string, and the first string is the Bhanu, second is the Pratap. So your output will be this: my name is Bhanu, comma Bhanu and Pratap, because you have my name is first dollar, comma, so your comma will come here, and percentage first dollar and second dollar, so you will get Bhanu and Pratap. That's how the formatting works. So another example of formatting where you have number called 7044, and when you say string.format %07d, comma num. So when you say %07d, which means, and when you supply the number 7044, so the three zeros, okay, we'll get added before three zeros. So when you say percentage, you know, 07d, the output is three zeros plus 7044. The formatted number, your output will be three zeros and then 7044. So that's how it works. So three zeros. So when, let's say, you want to add three zero, and when you say percentage 07d and then number, so let's say your number is 7044. And when you say percentage 07d, so your particular number 7044 will get formatted into 000744, right? That's how formatting works. So now we have another method called get bytes. This get bytes method, if you look at, it has actually two overloaded method. One is get bytes of this character set, and one is get byte of again character set, but this guy will throw unsupported encoding exceptions, right? This byte will return the, you know, array of byte, both will return the array of byte, but the second method, get bytes, the where we supply character set name, it will throw unsupported encoding exceptions. So if you look at here, we have a class called example one and we have a main method. Okay, now when we say string str is equal to new string Bhanu, and when you say str dot get bytes, so on that particular string, if you call the method get bytes, the return type will be byte of array. Okay, return type will be byte of array, and I'm just printing that default character set encoding. I'm running a for each loop. So since it is the byte of array, we can run for each loop. Okay, if you try to recollect the for each loop concept. So I'm creating one variable of b. So what is the type of b this is going to be? It is going to be a byte type, because from this array, one by one, the data will get assigned to this byte. So when we print b, every time your byte data will get printed, right? And then you put a print line, new line, and you do, you know, system output print, you know, etf 16 character set encoding. Now there are another kind of encoding where from that string, whatever, you know, a string we have dot get bytes, here we are just calling the method called get bytes. Here we are calling the method get bytes utf-16. So this is, you know, another kind of character set encoding where you can encode your character. So you are calling the method called get bytes, and in this you are supplying the argument utf-16. So again, when you get the byte of this character Bhanu of this utf-16, this will give you again, you know, a byte of array. Again we are running a for each loop. Similarly, from that particular string we can get the byte of utf-16be. So this is, you know, different kind of character encoding which we do. So again, when we do get bytes, we'll get a, you know, a byte of array. We are running a for each loop, right? And we have this code, okay, we have this code into the try catch block. So why into the try catch block? So it will throw the exceptions, it will throw the unsupported encoding exceptions. That is the reason we are keeping this code into the try catch block. And if you look at the output, okay, the first output, this one b, right? So I am not putting here ln. Why I am not putting here? So that my output will be into the same line, it will not generate new line every time. So I'm not putting, you know, ln here. Let me show you this through Eclipse. Make a main method, paste it here. Okay, now this we have into the try catch block. This piece of code we have into the try catch block, and this will give you the unsupported encoding exception. So import this, just place mouse over there and import this. You got imported. Now when we are running here for each loop, we don't have ln here, new line. When we print a new line, everything will get printed into the new line. So let me show you by putting the new line here, and let me run that, this piece of code. So you can see that 66 104 97 110 and 117, because every time, you know, new line got generated. So this is the default, you know, bytes of this. So when you convert the string into the bytes, you'll get like this. This is the byte code. Okay, 16 104 97 110 and 117. Similarly, when you convert the string into the utf-16, when you do encoding of utf-16, these are the, you know, standard encoding of the characters. And when you do that, again you don't have print line ln here, so it will print in the same line and you will get this outcome, right? Again, for 16 BC, you will get this encoding outcome. So this is, you know, different way of encoding your character. You can encode your character. That's what we have given here, right? In above example, we have done encoding using character set UTF-16, UTF-16BE. There are many other standards character set, like these are, we have US ASCII, then ISO, then UTF-8, UTF-16BE, UTF-16LE, UTF-16. So you can read these descriptions, right? 7-bit ASCII, AKA, this US AKA, and the basic Latin block, ISO Latin alphabet numbers, 8-bit USC transformations format, 16-bit USC. These are the, actually you have, you know, different kind of character set encoding, okay? You don't need to remember all that. You just need to know, when we do a get bytes, we will get the bytes of data, okay? This is not, this method is not widely used, but at least for your knowledge, you can try to understand this, okay? With this, I will close this video, and in next video, I will also talk about some more methods of a string class. Thank you guys. Thank you for watching this.